Hi everyone in cloud computing and welcome to episode 51 of the Cloud Computing Australia show with Brad Nelson and the world's number one cloud industry expert and thought leader, David Linthicum. This show is sponsored by Nelson Hilliard, cloud computing recruitment specialist, placing great people in cloud, IoT, fintech and AI. In this week's show, we are talking about that tech companies are under increased scrutiny regarding security, examining the relationships between what's good for business and what's good for individuals. The Australian government has welcomed the passage of the Clarifying Law Overseas Use of Data, or the Cloud Act, by the US Congress in late March. Hi Dave, it's great to have you back on the Australia show this week.
No, it's great to be back, and this is kind of a very topical topic.
Yeah, it certainly is. So look, maybe an opening question then to sort of start the show off is, how do you see the collective impact of the Cloud Act, and what other forthcoming laws do you see affecting Australia?
I mean, it's everything and anything. I mean, one of the things that we have to understand if we're going to get into business today as an international company, and pretty much everybody's going to be an international company, is that you're going to have to live in a world where you have to dealing with the laws and regulations of other countries. And I think that the ability to kind of understand where these things are going and get ahead of them, you know, versus reacting to them is really going to be the, you know, path of success. And one of the things I was very impressed with is that Australia actually seems to be getting used to this stuff before it pops up. So they have the Cloud Act, they have, you know, GDPR, and they have all these other things that are popping up as regulatory pressures they have to deal with, if they're leveraging cloud-based systems or any systems for that matter. And they're able to adjust, so by the time they show up, and by the time they become a relevant thing, they've adapted to it. And I really wish that other countries kind of learn the same lesson, because everybody else seems to be panicking about this stuff.
Yeah, people do seem to panic. I've got some friends, well, friends all over the world and business associates all over the world. And people either do two things. They either want to be really knowledgeable about it, or they've got that ostrich effect where they immediately want to put their head in the sand and completely, or is that the emu effect? I can never remember. But one of those birds where they just bury their head in the sand until something comes and literally bites them on the ass. And then they kind of firefight the problem from there onwards, which, you know, isn't great. So you're from your personal experience then, you've had a good call on Australia, have you?
Yeah, I think that, you know, this thing, the article that we're pointing to here is just another instance of it. So ultimately, you know, the folks within Australia realize that they're going to be, you know, take this the wrong way, but kind of a more minor player than a lot of the big countries out there. And they have to acclimate to the existing regulatory pressures. So where people have a tendency to push back on this stuff and you know, what we call the United States whistling past the graveyard, really just don't understand that this issue is coming forward. Australia businesses, generally speaking, by the way, there's lots of businesses that don't do this, are able to adjust in kind of an agile way to the changes that are occurring overseas. I mean, I was at reInvent this week and I met a ton of Australians who were in essence at the event and dealing with some of the legal issues. And, you know, one of the words of wisdom they told me, they said, listen, look, we have to play nice with everybody, and our ability to get ahead and being the most nice people to play with in the economy is going to be our the attraction to success. In other words, our path to success. And so while everybody else has a tendency to have a lot of latency with these sorts of things, the Australian culture within the banks and other major companies that basically live there and leverage cloud computing-based systems as well as other systems are perfectly okay with the laws changing, and they're not necessarily threatened by it. And I think that's the way you should look at it. I mean, you're not going to be able to stop other countries from creating odd regulations or your view of odd regulations, but you got to work with them. And so I see with blockchain coming, there's going to be more regulations around that. Lots more breaches are starting to show up. Lots of regulations around the ability to stop the breaches as politicians react to, you know, kind of knee-jerk reactions in the industry. And Australia say, hey, bring it on. We'll just go ahead and adapt to whatever you guys need us to adapt to. And we're going to become the best country in the world to do business with. And that's going to be the path to success. And you know what? I can't disagree with that.
Yeah, it's one of those things. I mean, the Australian government seemed to embrace quite a lot of things that we've covered on the shows before about blockchain and the GDPR, which we covered in quite a lot of detail with Katrina Dow, actually, on a couple of episodes, well, a few episodes back now. We did some great deep dives on that, which was fantastic. I'll put a link in the description for that particular show. But I mean, Microsoft in Australia are embracing that the Cloud Act. I think that's important because that's actually now switched into Australia. The actual Australian government have welcomed it, and I think that's really key, isn't it? That the governments are recognising what the boundaries and what the rules are that are set by, say, the US. Like you say, it's always going to be a slightly smaller player than someone like the US, just based on, you know, sheer demographics and the capacity of the amount of work that goes through the nation. But I mean, that is quite a breath of fresh air when it comes to another government embracing something like the Cloud Act, isn't it?
Yeah, and quite frankly, there's lots of companies in the United States and even in the European Union that are, you know, hiring lobbyists to, you know, try to change the laws and fight back upon it. And I think that you're going to end up spending more money and time and, you know, just kind of sweat capital in trying to get those things done versus actually adapting to the laws. I don't view the Cloud Act or the GDPR or some of the Chinese privacy regulations or some of the regulations that even coming out of Australia as very onerous. And so you're able to basically create technology around them, automate your way through them. And by the way, learn as you go to put volatility of these laws and regulations are going to change into their own domain. So you're able to change them through a configuration mechanism versus, you know, reprogramming everything. And I think that your ability to adapt to these things is really going to get to your success. It's not your ability to fight these things or lobby with these things, things like that. These things are going to be ongoing for the next 10 years. Everybody's going to have some sort of political agenda. There's some odd laws that are coming down, you know, from the European Union and the United States and China, and it's going to continue. And I think our ability to adapt to them is going to be the pattern of success. It's not our ability to push back on them, our ability to ignore them until they can't be ignored anymore. So I think that people are taking the right path in Australia, and also the Australian companies. In this case, you know, it looks like Microsoft and doing some stuff with the Australian government, and that's fine. But I like the fact that they're welcoming the passage of the thing and adapting to it versus pushing back on it and writing a, you know, 20-page document from lots of lawyers who are, you know, telling you why it doesn't make sense. They never make sense. None of these laws make sense, but you still have to adhere to them.
That's so true. So true. In fact, that moves me on nicely, actually, to ask you, but Microsoft are heavily working with the Australian government in a training plan. I think about 6,000 of their public sector workers are going through an Azure training plan, which is quite an interesting point. So that makes a lot of sense for them to be certainly joined up on this Cloud Act. What you say about a lot of odd laws coming, what do you find odd about the Cloud Act?
Just kind of the way it came about. I mean, this thing was basically dealing with some of the privacy issues and dealing with the overseas issues in terms of how a data I can access. And, you know, it's physically located in Ireland, and that, you know, ABC, public cloud company, owns it, and they're based in the United States. Do I still have access to it? And all these things were, you know, being fought out in the courts. And so what they did is basically said, well, this is what we're going to do. This is the Cloud Act, and this is where you're going to pay attention to those things. So no more lawsuits. We're all going to adhere to this sort of stuff. And that's why Microsoft kind of backed off on its lawsuits and some of the privacy stuff. It's a little, you know, disconcerting that information can be gotten without the permission of the people who own the information, and kind of that's what the Cloud Act's all about. But the reality is, it's like I said, I abstract myself from the political stuff, the laws and regulations. This is the way it's going to be, so you might as well adapt to it.
Yeah, you've got to take it almost as a given, really. It's been put in place. You've got to play the game. Otherwise, you're a naughty boy and you're in trouble and you're in the naughty corner. So we certainly don't want that, do we, Dave?
No, and that'll put you out of business, too. So you got to, like I said, get along to go along. That's kind of the way it goes in the United States, and as well as the world now in this international business climate.
So true, so true. And it moves on nicely to your top three tips this week, which would be fab.
Yeah, number one, you need to think globally and act locally. I know that's a bumper sticker, but the reality is that we think about what the entire world is doing before we actually change things that we're doing within the company. And so I I find this is a huge mess that's going on out there. People have a tendency to think about their own politics within the company, not what's going on globally, typically try to ignore it, typically try to bypass it, as you talked about earlier on. And then that's a mistake, because guess what? You can't get around the laws. You can't legislate from a company. Make sure you align your security correctly. I think the big thing that's occurring right now is that we're not necessarily keeping up with the regulations in terms of the security that needs to change. And so it is going to change the way you do security going forward. You have to really kind of lower your risk in terms of the way you're doing security. You're never going to have 100%, are basically 0% risk. It's going to be, a factor, factor 1 to 100, and that's kind of the way it goes. But make sure that it works for you. And then finally, make sure to align your governance correctly as well. And so one of the things about these regulations is they set parameters and things you're able to do and things you're not able to do. While governance systems have the ability to write these policies, which allow you to align and basically control and create guardrails for what your cloud-based systems can do and what they can do, what data they can access, geographical restrictions, encryption restrictions, things like that. We use these governance systems. I find that people are trying to program their way to success at the application level. Leveraging these governance based tools and technology is going to allow you to, in essence, be more successful at what you're doing with the compliance stuff.
Great top tips there, Dave. I feel another show with Katrina coming on. I think we're getting to that point where we need to have her back on the show, I think. So I'm gonna do a shout out to Katrina. Katrina, you need to come back on the show. that's my actual shout out. But great top tips there, Dave. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Are you happy for Katrina to come back on? Should we have her back on?
Yeah, I would love to have Katrina back on. We have any of our guests back on. We've only had excellent guests on the show.
That's true. In fact, I'm glad you said yes, because I didn't want to it to be a heckle and she says, no, I don't want to come back on your show. We had fun. I think we had a lot of fun, actually. So I'll make sure I tag her in on these when we're posting out these videos so she can come on the show. I'll get in touch. It'll be great to have her back on. And look, Dave, thanks for being back on the Australia show this week. Always a pleasure.
It's always a pleasure.
Excellent. And thanks for watching, everyone. We hope you enjoyed watching this week's Australia show. You can get Dave on Twitter, which is at David Linthicum. I'm on Twitter at Nelson_Hilliard. We're on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, everything like that. Remember to like, subscribe, comment, and share these videos with your friends and family. Click the notification bell. Check out the latest blogs. Everything's in the description box below. So don't miss out on anything there. And look forward to the next shows we've got coming up with the C-Suites and with the training show. And see you next week.